Alright, how's everything going? How's your project going?
Good.
Alright.
One good.
Alright, that's good. It's better than no good.
Yeah.
Everyone, let's put it this way. I am a little bit encouraged because I didn't see a look of shock on anyone's face when I asked about the project. Like, oh wait, we have a project in this class? So that's good. That's a positive. There are times when I have, oh yeah, we do have a project. And it's amazing. Every semester it's like this, you know, and in fact, not to sound like an old timer, but every year just goes by quicker and quicker. But every semester goes by quicker and quicker, definitely. And I'll tell you, like the time from like spring break to the end of the semester seems like 2 weeks to me. I mean, it seems like just a couple weeks ago was spring break. And here we are like week 14. So we have two more weeks left. So the project is an important thing, you know, bring it to a class, bring it to lab, so you can work on it and so you can share it with other people and let other people see what you're doing. Maybe they can give you some input. I can give you input if you want. And it's just a good way. I mean, it's good to get feedback before you turn it in. And that's an important thing. I almost feel like I should build that into the class, have that as an assignment. I mean, I won't do it because I won't, like, change the rules at this point. But it's almost, it would almost be a good activity to have everyone, like, do a critique of someone else's prototype, for example, or draft of project or something like that. Because I think sharing your work benefits both people in there. The person whose work is being looked at gets some good feedback. The person who is doing the review is thinking about it and might get some ideas for their own project. So I think it's good all the way around. So finishing up your project is like job one for the rest of the semester. Also finishing up your portfolio, which again, if you've been keeping up with the assignments, finishing up the portfolio should be a minor issue. Should be easy points, knock on wood. And I know that's easy for me to say, right? But at any rate, the last few classes we're going to spend talking about JavaScript, and we cover at least a little bit of JavaScript, for one thing, to sort of complete the picture of what goes on the client side. All right, we talked about the client and the server, and I'm going to draw my diagram up there on the board in a minute here, and the three languages that browsers understand, the three standard languages that browsers understand, are JavaScript, CSS, and HTML. Well, we spent all semester talking about HTML and CSS. I think it's important to sort of close the loop and to look at the third language, JavaScript, to at least get a sense of how it works with the other languages to make for a good, effective web page. So again, when I talk about client side, I'm talking about the person that is making the request, the computer that is making the request, or I probably should say device that is making the request, the person using their phone, their laptop, their desktop to make the device. And we talked just a little bit about server-side scripting, although we didn't have any real examples of it. We said that that's not covered in this class. But we talked about This looks like a brand new marker, and I don't know, maybe it's writing white on the board. We talked about the drawing where you have a client who, again, is a person sitting at their computer using their handheld device, whatever, but it's a person that's requesting a web page. They are connected to the internet. And again, the reason the internet is drawn like a cloud is because we're not interested in all the details of exactly how a request gets from the client to the web server. It's not as though every machine has a direct line to every other machine on the internet, right? So your request actually makes, it gets routed. It goes from server to server, from machine to machine, till boom, finally it ends up at your web server that you requested. And that's the part that we're interested in. It's like a bus trip, you know. I mean, if you were to take a bus from here to New York City, you'd stop in Erie, Pennsylvania, Buffalo, New York, Syracuse, and so on and so forth. All right? We don't care about all the stops that you make on the way. We just care that you make it to the web server that you've requested. So you send a request, which consists of a URL, maybe data from your form, and other info, such as your IP address, information about the platform that you're on. Are you on a Mac or a PC or an iPhone or whatever? All this stuff makes it to the server. And with server-side scripting, again, we don't have finished web pages out there sitting there waiting to be delivered. We have a script. We have a recipe. We have instructions in some programming language that takes a request and creates a custom response just for your request. So two people doing pretty much the same thing will get different information back from the server depending on maybe who they're logged on as, what they've entered in on the form, where their location is, whether they're on a Mac or a PC, and so on. You know, the great example of that is you do a Google search. Both of us could do Google searches, and the page that we get back is going to be drastically different. If I search for HTML and you search for Italian restaurants, you're going to get a whole different page than I do. All right? It's the same script as handling it, but the output, the response that the server creates is going to be different in each case. It's going to be customized based on all these factors. The other good example that you should all be able to relate to is Canvas, when you log on. Both of us log on, me and you, and our pages look different because it looks to see what classes I'm teaching. It looks to see what classes you're taking. It understands that I am a instructor, you are a student. Now, if the roles were reversed, let's say you were an accounting professor here and I was taking an accounting class, then for that one class, it would be different. I would be a student and you would be the instructor if one of you happened to be an accounting professor that was taking one of my classes. So again, it customizes the response based on all these factors. And according to the logic in the server-side script, and oftentimes interacting with a database. Now, this response consists of three parts. Two of the parts we've studied so far, right? HTML and CSS. That's the part that we've done. All right? The third part of this is JavaScript. And here's the idea of JavaScript. JavaScript allows small changes to be made to the page without going back to the server. All right? Now, why is that a good thing? It's a good thing because even though this doesn't seem like it takes a long time, because it really doesn't in terms of, like, you know, real time, human time. Like, if I were to go and type in ESPN.com on my browser, the page would load in, you know, 2-3 seconds. That's really not that much time, right? But in computer time, 2 or 3 seconds is a long time. Because this operation of going through the network, stopping in Buffalo and Syracuse and Albany before you finally make it to New York City, that takes a lot of time. And likewise, the response coming back. So this operation takes a lot of time in computer terms. If there are some little pieces of programming that are loaded on the client side initially that can tweak the page, we're not talking about like totally changing the page, but just make little changes to the page. And it can run here on this computer without having to go through the internet. The changes can be made to the page instantaneously without any sort of waiting, even 2 or 3 seconds. It'll happen within milliseconds, you know, thousands of a second. The other thing is that The server is doing important work here. It's creating web pages for people. If the change is small enough, minute enough, it's to the advantage of the server that you don't bother the server with every little tiny request that you make. If you can handle some of the requests on the client's computer, then the server can devote its time to doing the important things, the stuff that the server has to do. So the server, for example, is going to be interacting with the database. The client is not going to be interacting with the database. So this is a lot of work to do, to interact with the database. So something small, if the client can take care of that, that can leave the server devoted to doing the hard stuff. All right? So it's a win-win situation. If something can be done on the client side, the client gets a quicker response. The client gets their change without having to wait for it to go through the internet and come back. The server doesn't have to worry about those little small changes to the website. So it's a win-win situation. Win all the way around. Let me show you the kind of things that I mean. All right? And we're going to go to ESPN.com because they have a great example of it. And we'll get an idea of how this is a win-win situation for both the client and the server. Here's ESPN.com. How long did it take to load? 2-3 seconds. Probably less than 5 seconds. All right. Which, again, isn't long, you know, compared to a lot of things. But in computer terms, that's a long time. Now, notice what happens is I put my mouse over these menus. Boom. 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 They change instantly. Alright? And they change without going back to the server. How do I know that? Well, when you request a page from the server, let's click refresh here. You notice a little flicker. Alright? You notice that the page, even if the page refreshes very, very quickly, you'll notice like it goes blank for a second and then stuff reappears. Whereas here, we're not getting back from the server a brand new page, which we shouldn't, right? Why should the server have to send a whole new page back when all we're doing really is making a tiny little change to this page? So let's think about what's going on here, and let's understand it from the client-server perspective. So I go and I type in my request for ESPN.com. The web server does its thing and returns to me a web page. That web page consists of three things. Consists of HTML, which is the content of the page. It sends back CSS, which is the appearance and the formatting of the page. And it also sends back JavaScript, which is the behavior of the page. What do I mean by behavior? I mean the interactivity. So when I do something, the page responds with something. So, for example, I put my mouse over NFL, and boom, NFL appears. NBA, Major League Baseball, and so on down the line. All right? So that's interactivity, or sometimes it's called behavior. All right? Now, let's analyze what's happening here. First of all the content in the page gets delivered when the server responds to the client. So in other words, all those menus are always there. All right? So when I hit refresh on the page and when I load this page, it loads everything that I see, but it also loads some content that I can't see. All right? In other words, at this point, if I were to look at the source code for this, it has already loaded the menu for NFL. for NBA, for Major League Baseball, for college football, and so on. That content is there, it's just invisible. So, the HTML is there, and the CSS is set so that, remember, CSS has to deal with the appearance of everything? Well, one aspect of the appearance is whether you can see it or not, whether it's invisible. So the CSS is set initially to make all those menus invisible. So they're all there, all right, just can't see them, all right? So the server delivered all the content that you see plus all some content that you don't see, all right? And the CSS is what controls what you see and what you don't see. So the CSS for this stuff is set to make this stuff visible. The CSS for those menus that pop up are set to make them invisible. Now, when I put my mouse over something, JavaScript code is called that simply changes the CSS dynamically. It changes the CSS to say, oh, that NFL menu, it right now it's invisible, make it visible. When I take my mouse off of it, it says, oh, make it invisible again. Visible, I take my mouse off of it, it becomes invisible, and my mouse is on the NBA, so that submenu becomes visible, and so on. So anything that you can code in CSS, you can change via JavaScript. And you can change it when the user completes a certain action. So the user sort of triggers this, right? The user puts their mouse on something, the menu becomes visible. How does the menu become visible? Well, simply by changing the CSS. Change it from making it invisible to making it visible. Now we've already seen the case of making something invisible in CSS with our mobile example. So, and we saw how to make it visible again in the mobile and desktop example where the image was not available on the mobile version of the web page, but the image was available on the desktop version. So all we're going to do is we're going to write some JavaScript code to do that very thing based on where the user puts the mouse. All right, I'm going to start out with an example here, and it's a real simple example, but it's going to illustrate how the HTML, CSS, and JavaScript all work together to allow for this sort of interactivity. No one likes spoilers, right? So if you have a web page that has spoilers on it, you better hide them, or you better at least say that there's a spoiler. So, what would be a good spoiler that everyone in this class would know? What would be a good example of a spoiler that everyone in this class knows? Does everyone know who Luke Skywalker's father is? Okay, we're going to use that one. So I'm going to create a web page. And if you don't know that, then I apologize. But come on, folks, those movies were released in the 80s. You know, you've had plenty of time to watch them. Can't hang this one on me, you know, come on. So I'm going to go and I'm going to create my basic web page. Shouldn't be body, it should be head. I may have said before in this class, I admire TV chefs who like do things like chopping onions and stuff while they're talking. Because it's hard for your like hands to do one thing while your mouth is saying something else. So I think that's one of the reasons I type both every now and then, because it's kind of hard to do both. At least with this, I'm not like using a knife, so if I mess up, I'm not gonna like cut my finger. So that's one advantage that I have. All right, so I'm gonna make a paragraph. Luke Skywalker's father is Yoda. Oh, come on, I expect at least a chuckle for that. Or maybe it wasn't funny. Alright, I'm going to put a button here. And this is just going to be a plain old button. It's not going to be a submit button. Remember, a submit button sends your form, sends your request to the web server. A plain old button is used to trigger JavaScript. So I'm going to write a plain old button here. So I'm not going to say type equals submit. I'm going to write type equals button. Now I'm going to build this a piece at a time. I've done all of the HTML, if I could finish typing this line. So here's the HTML. What does the HTML consist of? It consists of all the content. All the content seen and unseen. So, here we go. I'm going to open it up. Luke Skywalker's father is Yoda. All right. Well, that's the HTML part, right? It contains all the stuff that we want to see initially and all the stuff that we want hidden initially. All right. Well, it's not too good if I show the spoiler right off the bat, right? I should make the user have to click the button to see the spoiler. So what I have to do is I have to hide the spoiler. So this is the HTML, right? This is all the content this page is going to have, at least for now. Luke Skywalker's father is Yoda, and a button that says show spoiler. I'm waiting for someone to run in from the hall screaming that Yoda is not Luke Skywalker's father. So that's liable to happen. So be ready for it. So, what CSS do I have to do? I have to put CSS to hide the spoiler. So how can I hide that spoiler? What am I going to use? HTML, CSS, or JavaScript to hide it? I'm going to use CSS. All right. And I could probably do this a couple different ways. But here's the way I'm going to do it. I could hide all the spans. All right. What is a span? A span just allows you to put a chunk of HTML in a container so that you can do stuff with the container. You can style it or use JavaScript on it or whatever. It's an inline tag, so it appears inline. I could hide all my spans, but I'm not going to do that. I'm going to tell you all the things I'm not going to do before I tell you the things I'm going to do. All right? Why am I not going to hide all the spans?
You might have more than one.
I might have more than one span. I might add a span that I don't want to hide. Then I'll have to go back and make a change to the CSS. So that seems like too of a brute force method to hide all the spans. I could hide the thing that has an ID, Luke Father. All right? What's wrong with that? I mean, it would work, but...
If you have more than one spoiler.
If I have more than one spoiler, I want to hide them all. So I wouldn't want to hide Luke's father, you know, the Luke father spoiler, the Leia and Chewbacca are brother and sister. I wouldn't want to hide all of those. I want to hide anything that's a spoiler. So how can I designate, how have I designated, and how could I continue to designate everything that's a spoiler on this page? With a class, all right? Remember, a class allows you to group things together and deal with them in the same way. So, more than likely, I'm going to want to handle every spoiler the same way, right? I can't imagine me wanting to have one spoiler dealt with one way and one spoiler dealt with another. If I do, that's an exception, and I can address that another way. So probably the best, most straightforward way to do this is say, hey, I have a spoiler here. I could potentially change this page to add more spoilers here, but all the spoilers I'm going to want to treat the same, where all the spans I'm not necessarily going to want to treat the same, and I don't want to necessarily go through and have to identify every single individual spoiler and set the style for it. It'd be so much nicer if I could just say all the spoilers I want to handle a certain way. So I'm going to go in, and how do I define a style for a class?
Dot.
Spoiler. Oops. I can do this a couple of different ways. But the way that we did it in the other example and the way that we're doing it here is we're going to set display to none. So now, I look at the page, and Luke's father is show spoiler. All right? Now, how would I make it so that I would show the spoiler? How would I change the CSS? I would change that to say inline. And if I want to hide it again, I would change it to none again. Well, there's not going to be an HTML programmer sitting at everyone's console saying, ooh, you clicked the button, here, let me go in and make the change to the CSS. That's what JavaScript does. JavaScript allows for that interactivity to change anything about the page, whether it be HTML or CSS, dynamically based on the user action. All right? Okay, so there's three things that we need to learn to write the JavaScript. All right? And this is the recipe for nearly all JavaScript. be able, first of all, to point to the thing on the page we want to change. The more proper term for thing is element. And then more specifically, we need to say what about that element we want to change. Actually, I'm putting these in the wrong order, but bear with me. What should have came first is this. We need to be able to trigger code based on a user action. We then need to point to the thing we want to change and then say what about that element that we want to change. Then finally, we need to write the JavaScript statement that does what we want. And it could be more than one statement. Now, there's exceptions to this, but this is sort of a good template for how a lot of JavaScript works. We have a user action that sets the ball rolling. In other words, when we loaded ESPN.com, the page just sits there looking at us until the user does something, right? There's a user action that triggers the get the ball rolling. And what's the user action? Put your mouse on one of these links. So that's the first thing we have, is a user action that triggers the code to start. We want to point to the thing on the page that we want to change, and we want to say what about that thing we want to change. Alright? And then finally we write the JavaScript statements that do what we want. So, these are called events. In other words, the user doing something, most events relate to the user doing something. This is called the DOM, Document Object Model. And this is really just sort of the meat of JavaScript. JavaScript syntax. So let's answer these questions before, let's answer at least the first couple of questions before we actually go and write the code. What user event do we want to have that's going to get the ball rolling? In other words, what do we want to do on this page to show the spoiler? We want to press the button. Alright? So, well, I said we'd answer the questions and we'd go and do that. So we want to press or click the button. What is it on the page that we want to change? What element do we want to change? When I press this button.
The Yoda span.
I want to change the span. I want to change the thing that has the ID Luke's father. Do I want to change the thing that has the class of spoiler? Let's think if I had 5 spoilers on a page. If I clicked a button, would we want to show all the spoilers? Probably not, right? What if someone had seen the first 3 movies but hadn't seen any of the more recent ones, right? They might want to see the spoilers for the other ones or whatever, all right? So, in this case, we probably want to show the one specific spoiler. So how do I identify one specific thing on the page? Well, the question contains the answer. How do I identify ID? All right? So if I want to point to something specific on the page, one specific thing on the page, I use the ID for it. So I want the thing on the page that has an ID of Luke Father. What do I want to do to that thing on the page that has an ID of Luke Father? I want to change the display from none to inline, right? That's what I did when I did it manually. I went in and I changed the display from none to inline. So I just want to write the code that does that. So I need to then know the instruction, how to point to the thing on the page as an ID of Luke Father, and how to change the value from none to inline. So let's look to see how we do that. First of all, as far as events go, they all start out with the word on. And in this case, it is an onClick event. So it's an attribute on the HTML tag, onClick. What are all the events that you can do? Well, we can look them up. On change, on click, on mouse over, on mouse out, on key down, on load, and there's even more than that. And they all have their role. On change is if I like change the value in a field. On click is if I click on it. On mouse over is if I put my mouse on it. On mouse out is if I take my mouse away. So, we go back to ESPN. On mouse over, put my mouse on it. On mouse out. Over, out. On key down is when the user presses a key. If you've ever played some HTML games, you know, it could include an on key down, that you do certain things with the keys to control things. Or if you use Twitter and it shows you like a countdown of how many characters you have left, there's a little snippet of JavaScript code that runs every time you press a key that tells you how many characters you have left. On load are things that happen as soon as a page loads. All right? We're interested on click. So on click means that the user clicks the HTML element. All right? So that's our event. Now, the user clicks the button, right? The user doesn't click the span. That may sound obvious, but sometimes people think that, well, this is the thing that changes, so I have to put the event on that. No. You put the event on the thing that triggers the change, not the thing that is going to change itself. So the button being clicked is what triggers the change. Therefore, it has the onClick event. All right? Okay. That was easy. OnClick. Next one is a little trickier. All right? We want to point to the thing on the page we want to change, the element. And we want to say what it is about that element that we want to change. All right? There's a specific syntax to this, and this syntax is unforgiving. HTML has a very forgiving syntax. You could, if you use capital letters or small letters, it doesn't matter, right? I could make all my tags uppercase or lowercase, and the browser will understand them. JavaScript is case sensitive, however. with HTML, if I put in a wrong tag, the browser takes a shot, and it might figure out what to do, and at least it displays your page. With JavaScript, it's more like a full-blown programming language, like Visual Basic, So if you make a mistake, nothing happens. All right? So, we want to point to the thing on the page. We're going to use what's called dot notation. And those of you that have done programming like in Visual Basic probably have seen dot notation. That's where you zero in on the thing that you're interested in. All right? First of all, let's go over this example. I know that the thing I want to change is on this page. How do I say it's on this page? I say it's on this page by the word document. It has to be lowercase. So document says, hey, it's somewhere on this page. Where else could it be? Well, it could be somewhere else. All right, it could be on a pop-up window that this page has created. So it is possible for this to be something other than document. All right. We want to find the thing on the page that has a certain ID. All right. The syntax to that is get element by ID. Then in parentheses, what do we have? We have the ID that we are interested in. What is the ID that we're interested in? Luke Father. This points to the thing on the page. This points to that span. Because document says it's somewhere on the page. Get element by ID finds the thing on the page that has that ID. So what is it that we want to change? We want to change something about its style. Alright. What about the style do we want to change? Do we want to change the height, the width, the font size, the... any number of things that we could be changing. But what are we interested in changing? We're interested in changing the display. And what are we changing the display to? We're changing the display to inline. This is actually kind of 2 and 3 combined. Step 2 and 3 combined. Because this is the actual JavaScript statement that we would run. So document, get element by ID, Luke Father, style, display, inline, equals inline. What does that do? That first of all narrows down what about the page that we want to change and what we want to change about it. Document says it's somewhere on the page. Get element by ID, Luke Father says, the thing that we're interested in on this page is the thing on the page that has the ID of Luke Father. Okay, what about that do we want to change? That's on this page that has an ID of Luke Father. We want to change the style. What about the thing on the page that has an ID of Luke Father? Do we want to change about the style? We want to change the style to display. And what do we want to change it to? We want to change it to inline. I'm going to go and paste this in. One thing you have to be leery of if you paste code from Word is Word actually has different kinds of quotes. Notice those are slanted quotes. Those will give you errors. So I'm going to retype those quotation marks. Now, if we look at this, we'll notice a problem. I'm going to zoom out a little bit here. I hope you can still see it. The double quotes are indicated to show the beginning and end of the JavaScript statement. We have quotes inside those quotes. Ooh. The browser's going to think this is the entire JavaScript statement because that's where the quote starts, that's where the quote ends. What can we do? Simple fix is make these single quotes. So I can use single or double quotes. And since I'm using single quotes, or since I'm using double quotes to go around the HTML attribute of onClick, I'm going to use single quotes inside of that string. All right, so that I don't confuse the browser as to where the JavaScript statement ends. All righty, so let's give this a shot. Luke Skywalker's father is, show spoiler, Yoda. Yay. Did what we wanted it to do. All right? Did exactly what we would have done if we had to hard code this manually. We went and we changed the style from none to inline. But instead, we used a JavaScript statement to do that. How do you suppose we would hide the spoiler again? Let's say I wanted to write code to hide the spoiler. What would we do? It's going to be similar to this, right?
To repeat the button.
Okay. So I'm going to duplicate the button. I'll change that to say hide spoiler. Now, what about this do I have to change? Yes. Just change the display to none, right? All the rest of it stays the same, right? Because it's still on the web page. It's still the thing that has the ID of Luke Father. It's still the style that we're changing. It's still the display that we're changing, all right? It's just that in this case, we're changing the display to none. Show and hide the spoiler all we want. Now, believe it or not, the code that does this is real similar to the code that did that. The difference is, well, we don't have a button, we have links. We don't have to click on anything, we just put our mouse over it. And instead of just being a word, it's a section that has a bunch of links in it. So instead of just a simple span that has one word, it's a series of links. But other than that, the code is very, very, very similar because it does the same thing. Now, JavaScript is unforgiving. So, for example, real common mistake. People say get element by ID and capitalize the D. All right. If you do that, then it doesn't work because it doesn't know get element by ID. How do you troubleshoot this? Well, again, staring at your code isn't a good solution. Go to More Tools, Developers Tools, and Console if you're running Chrome, and it will tell you. And what it says there, it says document get element by ID is not a function on line 17. And hopefully that should be enough to say, hey, document get element by ID. Oh, that's right. You use a lowercase d, not a capital D. Using the wrong case is a real common JavaScript error, especially for people beginning to learn JavaScript. So if it tells you that something doesn't exist, is not a function name, and you swear it is, make sure you have the case right. Alright? Likewise, if I had Luke Father with a capital L and a capital F, the ID wouldn't find it if I used a lowercase. So it's very case sensitive. This is the basics of JavaScript. It makes the page interactive. We can make some small changes to the page without having to redo the entire page, without getting back from the server a brand new page. We simply make changes to the page on the fly. All right. Of course, there's a lot more elaborate stuff we can do than this. All right. And we'll pick up on some of those things next time. We'll also take this and make some small variations for it, just to review. For example, we can use very similar code to change an image. You know, if you've ever seen a photo gallery where maybe they have thumbnails and then a larger version of it, we can use JavaScript code to do that. And we'll try our own sort of mouse over menus as well, like they have on the ESPN page. All right, we'll see you in lab.